have happened. Probably some that we can easily see, and maybe some that we don't realize that have kind of crept up on us.
Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the good lunch. Pretty good beans. So I appreciate that and look forward to. I think Mike's going to tour us around and look at some Harper cows here after a while too. We'll look forward to that as well. So I need to get going because I brought a lot of material. Aaron made the mistake of telling an extension guy, a state feed cattle specialist, that I had all the time I wanted. So I promised to get you out here in time to do chores in the morning. But I've got quite a bit of material. I thought I'd just see what you were interested in because there's a lot of facets related to this topic, and there's a lot going on in the country, in the U.S. beef cattle industry. It's a really exciting time to be involved in the cattle industry because of all these things that are going on. Obviously, we need a little rain to help make it happen. Aaron, I don't know if I'm not holding it right or what. Do I just not have it turned on, maybe? That little button that says on, maybe would help. So let's just take a minute then, and that, so I've been given a presentation kind of similar to this for a few years now, and sometimes I yank this part and sometimes I keep it in. If you've seen any of the Beef Improvement Federation presentations, you've probably already seen this, but for those of you that haven't, I think to me this is a good way to set up our history, so that you kind of understand what's going on in the industry now. People really haven't changed all that much. So let's take a quick stroll down memory lane. So this is the Grand Champion Angus female in the Chicago International Expo in 1953. All right? Not just some random livestock show. This is the premier livestock show in the world at the time, okay? And so, Dr. Bob Todashek, who gave this part of the presentation several years ago at the Oklahoma Cattlemen's Association, he called this the era of insanity in the cattle industry, and you can see why. Obviously, it led to a lot of problems, which one of the biggest would have been what?
Dwarfism.
I worked with a gentleman by the name of Dr. John Massey at the University of Missouri. He spent most of his career trying to resolve that problem. And so he dedicated an entire career to that. That is the Grand Champion female. And so you have to wonder sometimes, people in positions like myself, right, thought this animal was the best. And if somebody, the leaders of the industry at that time, felt like this was the direction we needed to go, and they put intensive selection pressure in that direction, and they made it happen, right? So through the 60s then, Dr. Todashek would say, well, there was recognition, widespread recognition that the pendulum had swung too far. And there was widespread recognition of need to change. This is about the same time in the industry when the Continental cattle were coming across the big pond, right? Charlet, Simmental, I don't think Gelby probably would have been here yet, but a lot of that influence. And so consequently, here we are in 1969. This is a picture of, anybody know who? A steer? Should be, when
it's
I
Don
left
Good.
Camp. Sorry?
It's Don Good.
That is Don Good, yes ma'am, right there. And he is the gentleman that's, I don't know if he became famous on this day, but it was definitely noted. He was the first ever to slap a Grand Champion at the Chicago International Livestock Expo that was a crossbred. And this is him. When I left K-State several years ago as an undergraduate, when I graduated there, this steer's picture was hanging on the wall. I don't know if it still is or not. This is Conoco. steer called Conoco. Actually, he still looks like a pretty good feedlot steer by today's standards. So then in the 70s and 80s, Dr. Todashek's words were that the industry returned to insanity. So what happened? Yeah, if a little bit bigger is better, well, why not? Right? So once again, the leaders in our industry, whether that was the seed stock, you know, breeders, whether it was the show ring, the livestock judge, one of the extension people, the leaders decided, and forgot to put on the brakes and decided that bigger was better. And we definitely got that accomplished. Whether you're talking about show steers or breeding bulls, and this is one of my favorite pictures. How many of those people do you recognize? I mean, unless you know what brand of boots they wear or something, I don't. Yeah, it's amazing. But it is kind of amazing how stubborn we can be as an industry. You see what I'm saying? Is that not ridiculous or what?
A lot of waste in the butcher.
Sorry?
A lot of waste in the butcher.
Yeah. Well, oh, that animal. Yes. Okay. So then, in the 90s and 2000s, you know, here we are, recognized once again that the pendulum had swung too far, right? And this, you know, those conditions, that situation, those kind of cattle also led to many problems. Some of those we're still trying to recover from. And so here we are, back again, at least in terms of physical size, frame size, you know, something that's very visible, easy to measure, and so on. So our industry most definitely has a propensity to create change and sometimes overdo things. So where are we at now? Let's take just a real quick stroll down that lane and just kind of look where the industry is at, and we'll start talking about calves. So from a post-weaning perspective, you know, my view would be that cattle have a tremendous capacity for post-weaning growth and carcass weight in our, no question about it. So that you're gonna see several of these. This is the crossbreed adjusted genetic trend for yearling weight growth, and that's for the 7 most popular breeds in the country. All right, so you've got Hereford, Gelby, Angus, Limousin, Red Angus, Charolais, and Simmental. On there. That's the genetic trend over time for yearling weight growth. Okay, so I'm really not interested in you comparing the breeds. What I want you to see is what's happening. And so it should be obvious to you that for over 50 years now, the cattle industry has just been really focused on, I'd consider it to be a never-ending arms race for growth. Okay? And so then, as a cow guy, I have to stop and look at that and ask myself, what good is that doing, has that done, for my cows at home? Now, obviously, it has created some advantages and positive things in the cattle industry, no question about it, and we're going to talk about some of those. But as far as the cows go, if you set aside a marketing advantage because your steers will perform better post-weaning, if you set aside perhaps improved carcass yield and those kind of things, if you just talk about cow efficiency, what good does that do your cows? And I've asked a lot of groups now, and so far I have not gotten a satisfactory answer or positive response, because I think it has nothing to do with cows. In fact, there's some antagonistic things that are going on when we continue down this path. And I think the industry is just beginning to figure this out. So it's working. This is a large data set with thousands upon thousands of feed yard closeouts that shows that over time, since the early 90s, sure enough, feed yard average daily gain or performance is going up. it's working. This shows what's going on with federally inspected carcass weight. Steers on the top there, heifers on the bottom. Carcass weights are increasing somewhere in the neighborhood of 5.5 to 6 pounds per year on average. So we continue to increase. Now, you know, this has been an advantage in terms of efficiency in beef cattle production. It's amazing how big we can get these carcasses now. And, you know, it's an advantage because, as I recall, I think maybe it's on my final slide, but as I recall, we're probably going to produce somewhere in the neighborhood of, 14% more total beef today, or this year, than we did 20 years ago. We're going to do it with 2 million fewer cows. That's pretty incredible. Post-weaning prospective cattle have tremendous capacity for marbling. So when I was in college, when I started graduate school and so on, kind of started paying attention to this kind of thing, seemed like year after year after year, federally inspected cattle, 50 to 55% choice and above. Okay, what is it today? Well, here's what it was last Monday. Okay, this is the USDA, and I don't expect you to read these, but USDA national steer and heifer grading percent. If we look nationally, you add the prime and choice together there, you're over 80%. Over 80% choice. Nebraska, that number is 84, a little over 84% choice. Kansas is going to be about 81% choice. Texas, it's going to be, 67, almost 68. So Texas is behind, always have been. It's an opportunity for those, for the people in the South to improve in that area. And they're headed in that direction pretty fast. They're trying to catch up. Really interesting things going on there. But so if you don't, I mean, we sold a load of cattle last week from a feed yard in Colorado. They graded 80% choice. 10 years ago, I'd have been patting myself on the back and thinking I'm a genius, right? Today, that's just average. They were nothing special. Cattle have changed. I mean, they have changed dramatically. Now, cutability, on the other hand, has declined a little bit. We've actually gone, if you think the yield grading system works, and some people think it does not, work as good as it used to. Is that fair statement?
Yes.
Greg, the meat scientist in the room. But it has declined marginally. So what I mean by that is if you recall the USDA yield grading system, one is extremely lean animal, lots of muscle, little fat. Okay? Five is extremely fat, very light muscle. All right, so we have fewer yield grade ones today, this is 2016 annual, compared to 1995. We also have fewer yield grade twos, and we have more fours and fives today than we used to have. But, you know, one of the reasons we're feeding the cattle a lot longer than we used to, but the cattle are capable of continuing to grow without dropping off drastically in feed efficiency. They're able to do that beyond what they used to be able to by far and away, and that's why we're able to feed them for so long. Real quick look at reproduction then, nationally. This one's a harder to get a handle on because there's not daily or weekly records recorded on this. You have to rely on individual farms. Daryl Peel came up with a pretty good way to look at it. He's just using the USDA NASH, National Animal Statistics Service, to look at the calf crop percent and the cow inventory, and he's come up with this sort of index on reproduction across the country. So what he says is that in the early 90s, we're running around 89% national weaning rate, okay? I think that's actually pretty darn close, because if you look at the North Dakota SHAPS program, cow-calf record keeping system program, if you look at the Kansas Farm Management Association data, it's right in that neighborhood, 89% weaning rate over time. And then also the Minnesota program, which probably has the largest data set in the country, and then the standardized performance analysis data from Texas, Oklahoma, New Mexico. Actually, it's lower. There would be the weaning rate has been flat and somewhere in the neighborhood of 83 to 84% in the South. Once again, behind in that regard in the South. I'll show you that here in just a second. But Dr. Peel says that through this 20-year period or so, fertility in the nation's cow herd actually has declined. The other data sets would not agree with that. They suggest that the reproductive efficiency has been flat. This way of looking at it actually says it's declined some. But leveling off, beginning to level off, who knows, maybe turn around, I hope so. So here's a look at reproductive losses across the North and the South. So this is using the Minnesota-based data, and it would cover actually about 10 states in the north central part of the country. Dropping down to Nebraska, Southern Plains, this is Texas, New Mexico, and Oklahoma. And so what I want to show you here is that pregnancy percent are lower in the South, higher in the North, but you have a little bit more calf death loss in the upper Midwest and a little bit lower calf death loss in the South. About 89%, just like Dr. Peel's data suggests, in the North, about 83% weaning rate in the South. So you can compare those to your own numbers and kind of see maybe where you stand. Okay, so to summarize our little history lesson in current conditions, we have a tendency to overdo things. Might be overdoing some things today. Dramatic improvement in post-weaning performance, total beef produced per cow, and carcass quality. We've made a lot of progress in that area. And there's my 14% more beef with almost 2 million fewer cows. Without question then, you know, it's interesting. I'm visiting with our teachers there on campus. They're always frustrated with students, and I swear every year they seem like they feel like students are getting worse and worse as far as paying attention and doing their homework and showing up for class and so on. And extension people gripe about producers too when you're not listening. But guess what? You know, we complain because there's still cattle coming to the livestock markets that aren't castrated, for crying out loud. You know, something as simple as that. And we don't seem to be able to make any progress on things like that. But when people like yourselves get a hold of a tool that works, I mean, look out, because those good science-based tools get used. And the EPD system, for example, it would be a good example of that, and making genetic change. Commercial cowherd fertility has made little progress over time. The exception to that would be dystocia. And obviously, you know, you all can probably remember a time when we had a lot more trouble with dystocia. And I certainly can, as a graduate student in charge of calving the heifers at Montana State University. I slept on a cot and checked the heifers every 3 hours and pulled a lot of calves. It's a good experience, but I'm not going to do it anymore. Okay, so where do we go from here? You know, there's a lot of opportunity, I think. We haven't had the tools that we have currently, but I'm going to show you where I think the low-hanging fruit is. Of course, being a cow guy, it's going to be with the cows. But so I think the opportunity going forward to make true progress is going to be with selection and development of females that excel, truly excel in fertility, lower cost of production, and maintain the post-weaning advantages and gains that we've made. Maintain those things. So I like to say, I probably shouldn't, but I like to say that it appears to me that we have truly focused for about 20 years now in the industry on post-weaning characteristics, feedlot performance, carcass characteristics, and we've actually just given lip service to the cows. And what I've just showed you, I think, is evidence of that. So let's talk about efficiency, fertility, stability, what's going on, and where are those opportunities. So some of you will be well aware of this, we call it technology, EPD, requires total herd reporting, right? These are the breeds that offer this, so let's take a quick look and see what's going on. Interesting story to me, I spent some time with the Red Angus group here a few months ago, and they were telling me the story about this. That group, they knew once they implemented total herd reporting, so if you're a seed stock producer, you have to send in the data on all of your females that are in the inventory, that are registered. And when they implemented that, they knew they were going to lose some membership. And in fact, they did. They lost about a third of their membership. Because some people are like, nah, you can have it. We're not putting up with that crap, right? And so let me show you what's happened since. But it was a tough decision to make. That's all I'm trying to tell you. It was difficult. So since 1995, and emphasis on fertility really has been quietly expanding since that time. So in stability, that animal gets a positive observation in the first half to calve successfully as a two-year-old. Then they have to produce a calf every year until they're at least 6 years old. So they produce a calf at two, then they have to be successful at three, at four, at five, and 6 years of age. They have to wean five calves in a row, and if they're successful with that, the sire's stability EPD goes up. Okay. Negative observation, if they miss a calf, come up open, call for soundness, production, disposition, body condition, corn. So there are other reasons for them to get culled beyond fertility. So it's not only specific to fertility. That's why they call it stability, because it has other reasons involved. So here's the genetic trend. This is Red Angus. Okay, so that's what's happened over the last 26 years. So they started right in here somewhere, and those are calculated backwards because of some of the data they had available to do that. But that there's the stability genetic trend for Simmental, and the genetic trend stability for Gelby cow. Now let's just take a look and let's put some numbers to that. If you go through the calculations, this is in percentage units. 4% Red Angus up to, actually this year, 2017, it's 11%. It's up to 11. So they've improved 7 percentage units. If you do the math on paper and you work that out, what did I tell you the industry's weaning rate was in 1993, two or three? About, what was it? 89%. Okay, so let's just assume that Red Angus cattle, with that genetic progress back then, was 89%. So what's happened in that breed is that their weaning rate would have gone from 89 to about 92 today. When the rest of the industry has done what? Fallen off about 5%. That's progress. Okay, that's what I mean by quiet progress. This is a new one. The Hereford Association released sustained cow fertility. Started talking about in 2015. Decided they were going to change their genetic evaluation. They pulled it back off the shelf, and they released it here on November 4th, 2017. it's going full blast now and is available, and you can get on their website and you can look up EPDs in these bulls. So this is brand new technology and it's really cool. I'm really excited about this because I think it's going to allow us to make some progress. Okay, so I'm hoping we only have one Hereford breeder in the room because some of you will recognize these bulls. But, so far I haven't gotten any calls to the dean's office about this part of the presentation. But both of these bulls have over 270 daughters in production, which tells you what.
AI.
They are lots of AI. They have been used heavily. They are well proven sires and very popular, actually. Okay? One of these bulls, and no, I'm not going to tell you which is which, has a sustained cow fertility, EPD, of plus 39. These are percentage units. One of those bulls has a sustained cow fertility, EPD, of minus 6. That's a difference of 45. It's a probability it's a 45% difference in probability of these bulls' daughters remaining in the herd when they are 12 years of age. Okay, so let's put some numbers to that. And this is why I think this is so cool. So given that each one of these bulls happened to have 100 two-year-old daughters that calved successfully the first go-round, 100 each, you come back 10 years later when these cows are 12, the higher fertility bull has a probability of 45 more 12-year-old daughters still in the herd. Is that cool or what? That's just a huge impact because of all the reduced cost of having to retain heifers and replace heifers, grow and develop, and so on. That is just phenomenal. Now, this is extreme difference. Most of the time, you're going to be considering, maybe a 5% difference in that EPD or 10 percentage units or EPD units difference, perhaps. So I'm giving it a very extreme example here from two heavily used bulls. Okay, so relative to beyond fertility, then, I think is most definitely a low-hanging fruit, particularly now that we have better tools to get at it. But also, let me just show you some of your own Kansas Farm Management Association data. Dustin Pendle has got some really nice publications on this. If you haven't read Kansas Farm Management's reports, some of the research papers, you ought to just Google Kansas Farm Management Association. Go to their website, look at all their publications, because there's some really good stuff on there. So in this study, 79 operations, data collected from 5 years, 2010 through 2014, 79 operations. And I think they had to have data collected from each one of these farms 3 out of those 5 years. Anyway, Dustin sorted those into high profitability and low profitability groups, like you see the economists do quite often. But he found a $415 difference per cow in profitability from low to high. I mean, incredible difference in profitability among operations. Now, the interesting thing to me is that about a third of that difference in profitability could be explained by things due to increased gross income, or output, if you want to think of it that way. Production units, weaning weight, weaning rate, calf price, and cull cow income. Two-thirds of the difference in profitability can be explained by cost. Okay, so there's where I think the low-hanging fruit is. And what I've showed you so far, I hope, shows you that our industry has been focused on this now for many years, right? It looks to me like the opportunity now is here. In Dustin's report, they discovered that 1 pound of added weaning weight in those 79 operations cost about 86 cents. And if you apply an 86% weaning rate to that, it wound up costing $1 to get another pound or increase weaning rate. So we just said, well, okay, so what's it worth? And so we just went to the Oklahoma National Stockyards data. We calculated the value of gain using a 500 to 600 pound calf. We said if we stay in that range over that same 5-year period when this study was conducted, what's that extra pound of weaning weight worth? It was worth 85 cents on average. Lots of variation due to the market, but 85 cents, it cost a dollar to get in that study. So you see what I mean by our focus needs to shift from the outputs and more towards the cost. All right, people's favorite topic, cow size. I've kind of de-emphasized this because I actually think we're getting there. You know, kind of like Dr. Todashek said, back again, we've started to moderate here. But, okay, so Mike, this is your time to shine. Who is this?
It's Ashburn Orange.
Ashburn Orange. It was the OSU. So we got to show off the K-State Conoco's deer. This is a little bit earlier, 1937. And do you want to tell us about Ashburn Orange, Mike? Remember anything about him? I know you don't, but
no. Yeah. I don't really know too much about him. But my dad was fortunate enough to have one 10 years later, or 9 years later, I guess, 46. And that steer weighed about 1,400 pounds.
Wow.
And he was probably right at 2 years old.
Huh. So what would this steer weigh, do you think?
I don't remember. Good, but I think he was a little lighter, but I can't tell you how much. So.
I'd be curious to know what that one weighs.
Yeah.
That was 1835, and that was in England. So why were cattle so big back then in Europe?
They were draft animals.
Exactly. They were, well, oxen. Aren't they called oxen in the Bible or something? But they were draft animals. That was their purpose. All right, so here's the genetic trend for cow weight in the Angus and the Hereford breeds. Okay, now they publish an EPD for cow weight now. You can see kind of what's going on there. In general, you know, there's a little bit of a dip and then a rapid increase, but it looks like I would describe this the last 20 years as sort of a creep in cow weight. We have not, the genetic trend for mature height or frame size has been flat since about 1987. Okay, when we came out of that second era of insanity, we've been flat in terms of frame size ever since. But cow size has continued to creep up. So if frame size hasn't changed, but cow weight has continued to creep up, what's going on? What has changed? It tells you their body composition has changed, right? What is it? Muscle? Probably. What else? I don't have a real recent picture. Well, Google the Denver champion this year.
Probably
steer,
fat.
Heifer, probably what?
Fat.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Probably. Probably. I don't know if they're any fatter today than they were in 1987. I'm not sure. Bone, maybe? There's a big one you haven't got to yet.
Thickness.
Capacity. Right? Yeah. Notice their bellies are getting really close to the straw again. Okay? What is that?
Organs.
It's organs. It's visceral organ mass. And guess what? The most metabolically, the most expensive tissue in the body, it's visceral, or it's the heart, the lungs, the intestines, right? Those are expensive, that's expensive machinery to maintain.
In this article, was it you that read about cattle are outgrowing their organs? When they take them to altitude, they're having more viscous disease, and cattle, because their organs aren't able to keep up with their size?
It wouldn't have been myself, but I've heard about that too. There's a veterinarian at Colorado State University that probably, I would guess, maybe authored that article, but brisket disease is kind of his thing. And so the the broiler industry went through this too, right? They had lots of health problems because they're, I don't know if you consider it their heart would explode or what, but they're growing so fast, putting on muscle so rapidly that their visceral organ tissue just couldn't keep up or something. So I want you to see that gradually over time, this is starting to taper off a little bit. That's kind of what I wanted you to notice. This is Red Angus, I'm not here to act as a commercial for the Red Angus group, but I think this is really interesting. Look what's going on in terms of genetic trend for cow weight and Red Angus group. They're coming down, and they have been now for almost 10 years. So that trend coincides with the time when they implemented their maintenance energy requirement, EPD. It's still the only one in the industry that I'm aware of. Is that true, Sandra? That's fascinating. And this is actually Larry Keenan sent this to me not too long ago, but this is their actual phenotypic trend over time in mature cow weight. What I want you to see here is they peaked right before they started going the other direction. They peaked at around, I don't know, 1250, 1275 mature cow weight, and now they're clear down to right around 1200 pounds. Okay? And when I talked to the Red Angus group a few months ago, I said, you all need to stay right there if you can. I think that's probably pretty close to an optimal cow size for a large portion of the industry. Now, obviously, you're going to have lots of variation around that, right? Because everybody gets to do, that's the wonderful thing about the cattle business, you get to do whatever you want. And so, to me, that's really interesting, and I think their maintenance energy requirement, EPD, has probably encouraged that. Okay, so we've collected several data sets like this, and it's real simple. You all can do it. If you have a set of scales, just weigh and score your cows at weaning time and weigh your calves. And then it'd be best if you adjust the cow weights to body condition score 5. We can help you do that. It's a pretty simple thing to do. And then probably the best weaning weight to look at would be an adjusted age and dam age adjusted weaning weight. But when we apply those adjustments and we just look at cow size to calf weaning weight, this is the answer we got in at least 3 large data sets. There's about 3,000 records in this data set. Okay, and so what that says, that if you look at the blue line, as cow size goes up, so does weaning weight. I mean, no kidding, right? But it looks like somebody nailed that with a shotgun, doesn't it? What does that tell you?
They never.
Well, it tells you there's really not a strong relationship. There's a lot of other things that influence calf weaning weight than cow size. In fact, a lot of things that are more important than cow size. You've got some cows here. How'd you like to own this girl? What's that, 320-pound weaning weight, and she's only, what, 1,900-pounder? She should have been fired a long time ago. And then there's these cows. She's weighing about 800, and she's probably Jersey or something. 680, right? And that, you know, I use this to tell people that we really get focused on that relationship. You're going to have some really big cows that are pretty darn efficient. You're going to have some really small cows that don't do a very good job, and everything in between. Cow size is not strongly related to calf weaning weight. Now, in general, though, cow size influences your stocking rate, or should influence your stocking rate decision. So as a herd average, cow size is really important. Individual animals, not so much. Okay? The relationship here in these 3 data sets, every 100 pounds of additional cow weight, we got 6 more pounds of calf weight more. I'm like, whoop-dee-doo. it costs for each 100 pounds of additional cow weight costs about $42 a year to keep around. Okay, and you're getting 6 pounds of calf weight to pay for it. Now, since then, we've been scouring the country looking for other data sets like this, and we've found several that have a higher relationship than our 6-to-1 in Oklahoma. The highest we found is 28, and that was Chris Ringwald's data in North Dakota. Okay, so 28 pounds additional calf weaning weight for every 100 pounds of cow weight. That gets closer to paying for the $42, but it's still not enough. So that's why I say, you know, we need to halt the creep on cow size, and we probably need to back off some. At some point, if you get too small in cow size, you know, you're probably going to have smaller frame cattle that don't perform well post-weaning, and that becomes an important thing from a financial standpoint, from a calf price standpoint. And so we need to consider that. Okay, so this is why I say the industry is about to get on top of this, and that is because this is what's going on. I showed you the steer and heifer carcass weights earlier. This is the cow carcass weights over time. Notice what's happening here. You know, you can see what happened. What was going on right here?
Drought.
It's the drought. 2011, 2012, back to back. We're sending thin cows to the packing plant, and so it really pulled this curve down for those few years. But in general, over time, this is flattening. In fact, it's almost flat now. So the cow weight creep is just about to stop. Okay, and I actually think it would do the industry some good. It'd better match cattle to forage resources if we'd actually back off a little bit more. Now, I'm not saying we need to drop way down in cow size, but we could probably use fine-tune a little bit smaller mature cow size. Okay, one of my favorite topics in the world is milk. So let's just talk about milk production then and better matching cows to forage resources and cow efficiency. So that's the same crossbreed adjusted EPD for genetic capacity for milk. Same 7 breeds, same period of time. You should be able to compare those lines if you care to, and you just have to recognize that this is based on the environment that's provided at the Meat Animal Research Center. There's a little bit of controversy as to whether that, you know, that is applicable to different parts of the country, and it probably isn't, but this is the best data we have. Interesting to me, of course, you're probably aware, so this is, let's see, what is this, Gelby? Yep, Gelby, Simmental have actually, not so much Gelby, but Simmental actually have gone down a little bit in their genetic capacity for milk production. Genetic trim for milk EPD. A lot of breeds would you consider to be kind of trending sideways. The Angus breed has been relatively aggressive selecting for milk production or genetic capacity. Hereford breed is quite a bit behind and trying to catch up. And I told the Hereford group in Kansas City 2 years ago, I said, I think that's a mistake. And I'll show you why. What happens when you crossbreed animals? What happens?
They get bigger.
Well, they get bigger, this is true.
Heterosis
is what? Bigger. What is the definition of heterosis? The average of the two breeds?
Additive.
I'm sorry?
Additive.
Additive, right? It's the average of the two breeds plus. And plus is heterosis. So, the average of any of these three breeds, which, by the way, did you recognize that Simmental, Red Angus, and Angus are neck and neck in terms of genetic capacity for milk? Did you know that? The cattle have changed. Okay, that didn't used to be the case, right? It's way different today. Because these cows, Simmental and Gelby, came into this country as what? From Europe. As what?
Draft.
Well, draft and milk. And, yeah, so they were dual, maybe triple purpose breeds. Anyway, where was I? So if you crossbreed Hereford to one of those three breeds, you're going to wind up somewhere here plus, right? So you're going to be right in this range. And if I apply our conditions in Stillwater, Oklahoma, to the optimal milk module provided by the American Angus Association, I type in our details, guess where it says we need to be relative to milk EPDs? A little, 12 would be pretty close, 12 to 18 actually is what it says, but it says we need to be right there. What happens when I cross one of these with a Hereford? I wind up about right there. The Hereford breed is in a very good position, it looks to me like, relative to matching cows to forage resources. I think that would be a pretty good match. Okay, so I'm going to pick on the Angus breed just a little bit here, not because, I don't know, this gets me in trouble, but so we have a lot of Angus genetics at Oklahoma State. This is happens to be a herd of Angus cattle, and I would say relatively representative of breed average, maybe above, they would have used from our purebred center there, above breed average sire milk EPDs in the Angus breed. So my graduate students milk a lot of cows, and we've milked this herd now for 3 years. I just kind of inherited it from another faculty member who retired. And this is where they're at, 31 pounds at peak lactation. It would have been 1996. The National Research Council assumed that the average milk production of beef cattle in the country was about 15 pounds at peak. Okay, this time around they assumed it was about 20 pounds at peak. This time around meaning they published a new beef cattle manual in 2016, the end of 2016. They said it was about 20 for Angus cattle. Well, I got news for them. They're behind. Our cows give 31 if they're in body condition score 5 at peak. Those cows do. That's a lot of milk.
What time of year are you measuring that?
Well, those are spring calving cows, and so we're measuring that in May.
Okay.
When the forage is pretty good. Well, we have fantastic quality forage in Oklahoma for about 2 weeks. And then it's downhill from there. That's what Don Gill would used to tell me, Greg. But I think that's true. Really good forage quality for about 2 weeks. So the problem is that according to some of this classical literature, milk production is associated with maintenance energy requirement. And the maintenance energy requirement is basically the overhead to run the factory 365 days a year, whether there's any widgets going out the door or not. Right? So that maintenance requirement's with you year round. And this would say, this older literature, and it's not a terribly strong relationship, but it is positive. And so it would say that for every 10% more peak milk yield, your maintenance energy requirement goes up by about 5%. So it's a pretty big impact on the amount it keeps to amount of cost to keep a cow around for a year. So let's switch from that then, and let's just talk about a real simple thing that we seem to totally glossed over. This is why I enjoy this topic. This is an area we're working on now. Just a simple conversion. I know why we don't. Because we've been milking cows a lot. It takes a lot of beef cows. It takes a lot of patience. A few trips to the emergency room. I have a broken thumb right now in my group of students, but it's hard to do, right? And so it's one of those things we just don't get to measure. And so we've sort of just totally glossed over, but the simple conversion of milk to calf gain. Let's take a look. All right, this is Dr. Twig Marston. Anybody recognize that name? K-State, right? This was his master's degree work there at K-State. One of the classical studies to see if milk EPDs actually worked early on. His data here, both Angus and Simmental cattle, said, sure enough, higher milk EPDs means more milk. They work. It also said higher milk EPDs equals more calf weaning weight. Well, that's how Milky Ditties are calculated. Calf weaning weight is how those are measured. But it took 71 pounds of additional milk in an Angus cow there west of Manhattan, Kansas, to make one more pound of calf weaning weight. Okay? Nobody paid any attention to that number. In Simmental cattle, it was quite a bit better. It was 31 pounds of milk per added pound of calf weaning weight. Okay. So let's look at another one. This is a classical study, Lewis and others, 1990. They had three different herds of cattle. Dr. Togshek actually did some research like this too back in the day. These are groups of cows that were bred for different genetic capacity of milk production. You've got low genetic capacity cows, moderate genetic capacity cows, and high. And that conversion of milk to calf weaning weight was pretty good when you're starting way back there where the Herefords were, right? If they didn't have much milk to begin with, that conversion was darn good. Moderate, and then you start out with a set of cows that already have a lot of milk, not so bueno. 52 pounds of milk to get one more pound of calf weaning weight. Okay, this is our data. We're about to send this off to the Journal of Animal Science. What you've got here is 100-day milk yield, so if you want to see their average daily milk yield, just divide those by 100. Okay, so around, you know, average in this herd, average of 25, 26 pounds of milk yield, and this is change in calf weight. So that line there represents about 55 pounds of milk yield per additional pound of calf weaning weight. This is a study of two-year-old heifers. In our operation, this is actually not significantly positive, but if you assume it is, that number is 66. And these are Angus and Angus Hereford crossbred females. Then the question becomes, how much feed or high quality forage does it take to make one more pound of milk? You got to know that too, right? In order to calculate the cost. So we've been doing that, and here's what we've discovered. You know, a relatively decent relationship here, and the rate is about 2 to 1. So high quality forage, meaning peak of the year quality, so April and May perhaps, and we're using, in these studies, we're using a diet that kind of mimics that energy value in high quality forage. So we can make milk relatively efficiently. That was in North Dakota this summer. This is a two-year-old. Wow. 1,000-plus pound adjusted weaning weights. Just incredible. But let me just show you then a summary on this milk production. So increasing milk is relatively efficient. We can do that, 2 to 1, right? As long as you've got the resources to support it, a cow can make milk relatively efficient. More milk means more calf weaning weight. Sure enough, in all of our studies, it looks like you wind up with an improvement in weaning weight. Even though, on average, and I'm just showing you 5 study average here today, it was 55 pounds of milk for each pound of added calf weaning weight. And guess what? Have to multiply that times 2, right? To get to the number of pounds of your pasture, high quality pasture or feed, it takes to get one more pound of calf weaning. That's why I think, in general, if you're a commercial cow-calf operation and you have moderate to low input production system, in other words, your cows don't, you know, get 10 pounds of feed every day. So a low input system, we need to probably back off a little bit in terms of milk, genetic capacity for milk production. Last reason I'll give you is this one, and that is the environment frequently limits the genetic capacity. Okay, so you know, I like to give the example of just bringing the top Dairy Herd Improvement Association cow from Minnesota down here and dump her out here on a pasture of cold water and get feed her a couple pounds of cake. So she's given 100 pounds up there, and you measure milk production after she's been out there for a month, what's going to happen to her milk production? She might dry up.
Die.
See what I'm saying? Has her genetic capacity changed? Not a bit. Same cow. The environment is limiting her capability. Now, do you want to be in that situation? Not so much, because you've got a higher cost factory, right? From here, and on this slide, these are kilograms, whatever. These are Brangus EPDs, but Brangus females. But from here to the right, what you've got is a factory that's more expensive to run, producing no more widgets. See that? So there's, you know, if you're in that situation where the environment is limiting their genetic capacity, I mean, you're driving a Peterbilt to work, for crying out loud, to the office every day. And there's just not much sense in doing that when you can drive a, what is that new car?
Chevy Cavalier.
So, you know, it can be done. This is the herd that's been selected now for about 15 years for moderation. Moderation in growth, moderation in mature size, moderation in milk yield. Different time of the year, fall calving herd, the Angus cows though at peak lactation are given 22 pounds. The Hereford cows, by Angus crossbred cows, are given 20. These cows are less expensive to keep around. A few things about maintenance and growth, and then we'll wrap it up here. Okay, so I just want you to recognize, we'll kind of pull all these things together, what happens over time in terms of the cow herd if you continue to aggressive selection for growth, gradual increase in cow size, which again, I think we're about to overcome that, bad habit, and genetic potential for milk. What happens? Well, this is, you know, we can show you several different indicators. One is, I like to look at, is the Angus Association's dollar ENEPD. And that's calculated primarily based on cow size, mature size, and milk yield. Okay? And so look what's happened over time. And that's dollar savings per month. So high is good, low is bad, and it's gone down very dramatically over time. Why? Well, it's because in the Angus breed and several other breeds, there's been, you know, aggressive selection for milk, and mature sizes has crept up, which means cows are more expensive to maintain. Why does this keep happening? Was because everyone assumes that the value of the output is greater than the increased cost of the cows. Isn't that what that says? Isn't that why this continues? Am I wrong? Doesn't that have to be what we assume? It also says that there's no limit to the environment. Or we're willing to spend more on the feed bill to make sure that there's no limit to the environment, right? So in other words, we're probably creating cattle, and not just in the Angus breed. And I'll show you evidence that it goes beyond Angus in a few minutes. But it means we're creating cows that like to eat more, right? They have greater appetite. And certainly the feedlot cattle have greater appetite today than they did 20 years ago. Ask any feed yard consulting nutritionist. This is what happens. This is just the Angus breed's EPD for dry matter intake. Now, you know, that looks bad. If you're in the cattle feeding industry, it's a good thing. Greg and I talked about that on the way up here. This is a positive thing. And it's created some positive things through our industry. But if you're a cow person, you know, and there is a positive relationship between these values and cow intake. It's not a perfect relationship, but they are positively related. This is good. It looks like now that, and we haven't had dry matter intake EPDs for very long. Sandra, how long have we had those?
Well, there's still that
camp out there that's not sure what the right measurement is, but it's been about 7 to 10 years.
Okay.
It's been hotly debated with EIF as to what the right measurement is.
But we've had something to go by, and yes, it's designed for feedlot cattle, but we've had something to go by now for 7 to 10 years, and it looks like it's beginning to moderate, right? It just a peak at it beginning to moderate. That's a good thing. I think that's a very good thing, especially for the cow-calf segment of the industry. But like I said, you give people a good tool, and they'll eventually begin to make use of it, and it looks like that's beginning to happen. I think that's a good sign. Okay, last study I'm going to show you here, and this one is really fascinating. This is just published in 2017. So, you know, if you look at that genetic trend over time, you would think that you know, as aggressive as the Angus breed has been at selecting for growth and milk, they might have been creating cattle that have a greater appetite. And that's basically what I want to show you here. This is in this Kelly Ritalik study, published there in Journal of Animal Science in 2017. They looked at, I think they had about 6,500 data points from steers and heifers on 18 different breeds. And I'm just showing you a few of them here. This is average daily gain. Angus ranked right up here at the top. So they used Angus as the base, and the base is zero. Everybody else is a little bit behind them, except for the South Devon breed, and they're about the same. If the number is bolded, it's significantly different. If the number is not bolded, you can assume there's basically no difference. Okay? So pretty substantial. We've all known this. So we know that Angus cattle now are growthy. And that's why probably they have become so popular recently in the South, because these other, particularly tropically adapted breeds, you know, don't do too well in terms of performance, don't do as well. What happens to feed intake then? All right, this is dry matter intake. I didn't take the time last night to convert this back to pounds. But on a per day basis, you can multiply those numbers times 2 and be close to pounds per day difference in feed intake. This is just the heifers. I'm just showing you data here on the heifers. And what that says is that, the heifers would have been on a corn silage, alfalfa, haylage diet. So a roughage diet, yeah, but a high quality roughage diet. It's not a feedlot diet. These heifers were not tested under feedlot conditions. They were tested under a heifer development ration conditions. So South Devon, basically three pounds a day, breed average, lower feed intake compared to Angus cattle. Wow. Right? I'm sorry if you're an Angus breeder, but that's how the science works. I told Greg on the way up here, you know, it's amazing how the fundamentals of science usually prove true over time. And that looks like that's what's going on here. So these numbers are all significantly different from zero, and these breeds average about 3 pounds a day. This would be about 2 pounds a day, lower feed intake. Very dramatic. Here's feed efficiency, and this is a change from Angus, which Angus are right here in the middle of the pack, and the only significant differences in these heifers, South Devon, Beefmaster, and Hereford. Okay, so interesting. This is a genetic trend for dry matter intake for Hereford, and they're headed in the same direction. Their dry matter intake PPDs haven't been available long enough probably for there to be much change yet. But hopefully, producers will begin to select for more moderate feed intake and get on top of that too. Okay, so wrap all this up, and then if you have time for questions and want to visit, we can talk about them. But inputs have been adjusted to maintain a higher input cow herd. You know, obviously there'll be specific cases where that's not true, as industry in the U.S., I think it is true. In many cases, I think modest negative pressure on milk production would improve the match to forage resources, and I'd say the same about mature cow size. I'm not saying we need to get crazy minimizing or reducing mature cow size, but some modest negative pressure on that trait would better match our cow herd to our forage resources. Fertility is beginning to improve. It's been quietly growing in some of those breeds, and we have the tools now, and there's really exciting developments as far as the genetics of early embryonic death loss. Okay, there it's still pretty early on in that effort, but that's gonna be some really good stuff. Combined with these new fertility, well, stability is not new, but things like sustained cow fertility and stability, we're gonna start making some improvements in that area in the industry. Dry matter intake, so these are all tools that are available now. Most of them are relatively new, and they are beginning, looks to me like they're just beginning to have a positive impact on these things. So, you know, while I've showed you that we've maybe been marching away from efficient cows for quite a while now, we're that ship is swinging slowly, and we've got the tools now, I think, that we're going to be able to start making some very positive progress. Genetics representing moderate inputs and regional adaptability are probably going to become more popular once again, and I'm referring to that Vitalik paper particularly here, because when we have the tools like the GrowSafe systems, the Incitec systems, and so on, we haven't figured out how to do it with a mature cow yet very well, but over time we will do a better job in terms of academicians, researchers, and so on, of measuring things that you can't, like forage intake of a cow and milk production. At least I don't recommend you try milking your cows. So it's funny, my 19-year-old son, when he was 16, he had a heifer, grew her up, calved her out. First time, he was 15, he come back in the house, he was breathing hard, holding his chest. I said, what's wrong? So his cow's just out in the pen, he goes out there and he feeds her in the pen. He said, my cow kicked me. I said, right here, she kicked him right there, nailed him, threw him back up against the fence. I said, how does that happen? He said, I was trying to milk her. I don't get it. So with today's tools, I think there's no need to give up or go backwards on the progress we've made in post-weaning performance and characteristics, quality grade, and so on, because of the tools we've got better. So thank you, and happy to try to answer some.